Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our Steel Group Talks. Today we have Professor G.G. Roy from Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. He is going to deliver a lecture today on magic of iron making. Professor G.G. Roy completed his PhD from Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur, and then he went to do the postdoctoral fellowship at Pennsylvania State University, under the guidance of Professor Dev Roy in the welding and simulation work. After that, he joined as a faculty member at Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur, and he is now full professor, as well as he also acted as head of the department from 2014 to 2017, as well as associate dean from 2017 to 2020. Professor G.G. Roy's expertise is in alternative iron making and as well as dissimilar metals joining, especially using electron beam welding, modeling and simulation. Today, Professor G.G. Roy is going to present some of the different research activities he is carrying out on alternative routes of iron making to produce clean steels. Professor G.G. Roy, thank you very much for accepting our invitation, and please present your talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Brookes, for your kind introduction. And I will just correct it. Basically, after PhD, I joined IIT Kharagpur. I was TRDDC Pune for 1 year. After that, I joined IIT Kharagpur. And from IIT Kharagpur, I visited a number of times to Professor Dev Roy. The title of the talk is The Magic of Iron Making. In fact, any process, who is not a process expert, to him, any process is a magic, in the sense, in a process, you give some input material and you get some output whose state, temperature, composition may be completely different from whatever the input you are giving. So, who is not a process expert, for him, every process is a magic. And iron making, especially the blast furnace itself, is a really looks like a magic. I'll just talk about that. Basically, in this process, in this tour, I will take you through a journey of different iron making processes that evolved over the years to suit the local conditions and local raw materials. And also, I'm touched upon the sustainable steel making for future because of climate policies. Okay. So first of all, I'd like to say I am just given a Google map of IIT Kharagpur. You can see from the sky, it looks like this. And IIT Kharagpur is a very huge campus. Okay. And it is around 2,000 acres. So this is the IIT Kharagpur, and this is the old area of IIT Kharagpur, and it is expanding in this area. That is the new area. And the recent around 5 years back, we have developed this new area, and we have 400 groups in Naranda Lecture Hall complex, where most of the lecture class will take place now onwards. It is being held, and Takshashila Computer Center. And also a 400-bed, that is the multi-speciality hospital is also coming at IIT Kharagpur. And because we have a school of science, that is the medical science and technology, and to develop the medical research, so this hospital is coming. So IIT Kharagpur is also expanding in the medical research. So IIT Kharagpur, at a glance, if you want to see, that is the start yet. This is very unique. It is the first IIT in India in the chain of 15 and 23 IITs. Now it is exist in India. And it started his life in the Heasley detention camp. That is in the British period, actually, it was the detention camp. And in that, monument, basically, we have developed the IIT Kharagpur in 1951. Okay, today we have around 12,000 students and 700 faculty members. And remarkable alumni is Lord Sushant Kumar Bhattacharya. Incidentally, he is our distinguished faculty and also the architect of WMG. We feel proud of him. and Sundar Pichai, you know, Google CEO. Besides, we have Vodafone CEO, Arun Sharin, and both those are there. With this very brief glance, let me back to my lecture. I start with, as I said, I will take you through the different iron and steel making processes. So this is just, in a nutshell, the different process in a phase diagram type of figure, because you can see the composition here on the y-axis and temperature in the x-axis. And you can see that our starting material is hematite that contains around 30% oxygen. Okay, and then our destination is here, that is the steel, that is the liquid steel you can find here. Liquid steel contained around less than 2% carbon and with some residual oxygen, maybe 100 ppm. So this is the destination. And we can come here by different route. One of the most prominent route, and this is basically the most dominant route, you can say, that is called the blast furnace and basic oxygen furnace route. That produced today around 70% steel. So the blast furnace, first you produce the iron, and this is the blast furnace route. You can find most of the oxygen from the ore is removed in the below 1000 degrees centigrade. If you see below 1000 degrees centigrade, most of the oxygen is removed. That means in the solid state, basically you reduce the complete, you basically remove the complete oxygen. And in the wet state, basically after that, iron melts in the lower part of the blast furnace and it basically carburizes. You can see it carburizes and it produces the hot metal, right? So from hot metal, you can again go through the basic oxygen process to oxidize the some of the impurities, and you can make a very low impurity steel. That is with less than 2%. I mean, medium carbon steel and 2.2% carbon, like that. Okay, so you can produce the steel here just after BF process. So this is one of the route, and that is the basic route that way you produce it. Besides, we have a very recent route that is called the smelting reduction route. What is this smelting reduction route? In this route, basically we avoid the coke. In the blast furnace is a very energy efficient reactor, but it is a very complex reactor at the same time. It has a dry zone, it has a wet zone, which is interfaced by a softening zone. So you can search complicated zone exist over the years, okay? So, and this structure exists because of raw material. The blast furnace is very choosy about its raw material. The raw material has to be very strong enough such that during the descent through the blast furnace and chemical reaction, they do not generate dust, such that the bed permeability both in the dry zone as well as wet zone is maintained, and you can have maximum interaction between the gas and solid for the maximum utilization, that is the utilization of the thermal and chemical potential of the blast furnace gas, that is the CO that is generated at the bottom of the reactor. So, and this coke is obtained from a special grade of coal that is called a coking coal, and the reserve for which is very limited, very scarce. As a result, people are looking for a coke-free process. Besides the coke oven, where the coke is generated, it also pollutes the atmosphere. So as a result, people are looking for the coke-free process. So how to use the non-coking coal, which is abundantly available throughout the world. In India also, we have a lot of reserve of non-coking coal. So smelting reduction route basically came to use the non-coking coal. And to use a non-coking coal, your reactor has to be changed such that you don't have the permeability problem, because coal is very fragile. It produces a lot of dust. And if you want to maintain the shaft like a blast furnace, you cannot maintain it. So people invented a reactor, a single reactor, where you can put this non-coking coal and iron ore, low-grade iron ore, even the that is the solid waste from the plant, and then you can melt it, completely melt it, okay? And in liquid state, you reduce the ore or the iron oxide to iron. That is the idea. So that's why you can see smelting reduction techniques. Basically, the oxygen removal takes place at very high temperature, about 1200 degrees centigrade. So this high temperature, most of the oxygen is removed, and then it gets carbonized and produce the hot metal. So that is the basic difference. So in case of the smelting reduction, everything is molten and then your reduction takes place. Now there are two-stage reductor, that is the two-stage melting reduction reactor are also there, where partially you reduce the ore in a separate reactor. Okay, so this is also a two-reactor process. One is the reduction reactor, and another is the melter gasifier. But these two reactors are independent, unlike blast furnace, where in the same reactor you have this dry zone. There is a reduction reactor as well as there is a liquid reactor in the same reactor. In smelting reduction, you separate this function of the two reactor in two independent reactor. As a result, you can easily use raw material. There is the inferior grade raw material. That is the advantage. And similarly, some direct reduction process also developed during this process, where basically you solid state reduce the iron ore in the solid state, not in the liquid. So you can see the temperature is 800 to 1000 degrees centigrade. So here you can switch your fuel here easily, because you can use non-coking coal, or if you have availability of the gas, you can use the natural gas also after reforming. So you can reform the natural gas to the CO and hydrogen, and then you can use it and you can produce a solid state iron. And solid state iron, you can find the carbon percent is very less, because in the solid state, carbon cannot diffuse into the iron. That is the thing. That is one thing. So this is the DRI. And this DRI, you can melt it in elliptic arc furnace and you can produce the liquid steel. So another thing, another metallic, solid metallics is the scrap. If you can convert the scrap directly to the steel, it is possible, because if you melt the scrap, the steel is produced. Because scrap is almost a pure iron, and you can adjust the chemistry a little bit in the elliptic arc furnace and you can directly go to the steel. And you can see the scrap is already metallized iron. Okay, so you don't require any reduction load. So as a result, the scrap-based process is emission is very less. Only the emission is involved into the electricity generation for the electric arc furnace. Even if you can run an electric arc furnace with renewable energy source, then scrap-based process becomes zero emission process. So it is a very interesting, but availability scrap is not that high and it will require time. Now with increase in the productivity, our use is also increasing, as also the scrap generation is increasing, but the scrap amount is not sufficient such that we can replace all this conventional process by the scrap process. But obviously in future we can expect this process. So the blast furnace iron making, as I say, it is the most prominent process till today. And I will give you some benchmarking. For example, blast furnace produces around 10,000 tons per day. This is, I think, the metal-based reactor. This is the largest metal-based. You can compare with any reactor. It is the productivity is the largest. Okay, no metal is produced in this scale. It's a 10,000 tons per day. That is the one of the benchmark for the blast furnace. And the fuel rate consumption is around, say, 270 kg coke plus 220 kg of PCI. After a lot of developments that has taken place over the years, now we have come to this stage. Okay, so coke rate has decreased significantly to 270 kg, and the PCI, there is the pulverized coal injection. You can use the non-coking coal in the blast furnace also through the tuer, that is called the PCI, that is 220 kg, and corresponding carbon rate become around 450 kg, and your total CO2 emission from the blast furnace, including the coke oven as well as sinter plant, it comes around 2 tons per ton of crude steel. And also the BOF carbon, you have to see in the BOF process also, the steel making process also, you generate some amount of CO2. If you combine everything, it comes around 2 tons of CO2 per ton of crude steel. Okay, and the specific energy consumption of blast furnace is around 11.5 gigajoule. And the furnace availability ranging from 95% to 98%. So you see, it is a so complex reactor, but at the same time, the furnace operates over the years without giving much of a problem nowadays. Okay, so its availability is 95 to 98%. But the major problem of the blast furnace is that from today's point of view, from sustainability point of view, it is because it is totally carbon-based reactor, so it generates a lot of CO2, 2 ton of CO2 per ton of there is the trend of crude steel. But according to the climate policy that was held in Paris 2015 December, and where aim was made to restrict the global warming less than 2 degrees centigrade after the from the pre-industrial period. So from that point of view, we have around 300 gigaton of what is that called remaining carbon budget. And based on that, our CO2 emission for the BFBA process has to be reduced to around 0.6 tons per ton of crude steel. From 2 to 0.6, we have to come for sustainable production of crude steel from the BFBA process. That is the big challenge. And people are achieving this through different innovation. So iron making in blast furnace, just I'll talk about little bit of iron making in the blast furnace because it is a very fascinating reactor. And Japanese basically froze this reactor and then by dissection, they have seen what is there inside it. Otherwise, blast furnace is a black box, isn't it? So it is a dissected blast furnace and it shows the different zones. You can find this upper zone is the dry zone where there's an alternate layers of wood and the coke like this. And lower part, this is basically the wet zone, okay? And the whole solid burden is held up by what is called the dead man's coke. This is the coke pillar is there that basically holds the lower burden because in the lower part, everything is liquid except this coke. So coke has two parts. One is the active coke that burn in the combustion zone producing CO and the necessary heat required for the blast furnace. And the other part of the coke that remains inactive, it is called the dead man's coke. Basically, it can be either sitting dead man or it can be floating over the liquid steel. And it basically holds the upper body. So this is the internal structure of the blast furnace. And combustion zone here, where basically carbon burns producing the necessary heat and the CO gas. And then CO moves through it. You can see this zone is called a cohesive zone, where you have an alternate layer of coke and the softened iron and the slag, okay, this region. So the gas cannot pass through basically this softened region that is shown by the hatch region, that is the softened iron, there is a liquid. And this white region is that is called the coke slit, that is the coke that basically allows the gas. So gas passes through the coke slit like this and passes through it. So it is a so complicated structure. So still, blast furnace is produced running smoothly and it is producing 10,000 tons per day. So is it not a magic? So this is the blast furnace. Now, blast furnace for sustainable development. Now, there have been two technology, that is the two potential technologies are there. One is called the top gas recycling blast furnace. Another is the low temperature, low emission iron making blast furnace, okay? So basically the top gas recycling blast furnace, it is the ULCOS project. ULCOS, you know, ultra low CO2 steel making process. And this is basically, you know, there's a consortium of 48 European companies and organization that took birth in 2004 after the Kyoto Protocol for minimization of CO2. So one of the major project of this organization is called the blast furnace, that is the top gas recycling blast furnace, okay? So what is there in this process? There are nothing because only thing is that in this process, instead of preheated air blast, you charge oxygen at room temperature from the bottom. So you are replacing the air by oxygen. That means there is no nitrogen into the system. Okay, so that is the thing. So oxygen and you are putting the coal. So, and then whatever the gas is generating, it is basically CO and CO2. And then from the top gas, you scrub up, you just scrub the CO2 and then whatever the CO gas is there, you recycle back into the furnace. So this CO gas basically do two function. One thing is that it supplements some amount of the CO, okay, because it is always going. And also it's increase the heat capacity of the gas because when you are giving the oxygen, nitrogen is not there. As a result, heat capacity of the gas drops significantly. So when you recycle the CO gas, you can make it up to some extent. And also, since you are recirculating the CO gas, so you can reduce the carbon rate. That is the most important thing. And you can reduce the carbon by 25% carbon consumption. You can reduce it. And 50% reduction in CO2 emission, because some amount of, after the scrubbing the CO2, some of the CO2 you can sequester. You can sequester some of the CO2. As a result, you can reduce the CO2 emission by 50%. And retrofitting with the existing blast furnace is also not a very difficult thing. Okay, so this is the potential technology, but yet to be commercialized. And there is another, this is a low temperature, low emission iron making. Here basically, you can see in this diagram, two things are superimposed. One is the FeCO phase diagram. This is the FeCO phase diagram. And this is called the wrist line. Wrist line means basically these lines are obtained on the operating line of the blast furnace. And this is obtained by heat and material balance. Okay, and after, and this line is fixed by two points. One is called the chemical pinch point, that is the Oosterite FeO, Fe. Oosterite means FeO, the Oosterite Fe equilibrium point. And on the, and another is called the thermal pinch point, that is, that comes from the heat balance. Okay, so then you have the straight line, and the slope of this line basically that gives you the carbon rate of the furnace. So if you can see that FeCO phase diagram, you can see the iron FeO Fe equilibrium, this line, if you can see, it is a very carbon intensive process. In the sense, say at 1000 degrees centigrade, you can see the FeO Fe equilibrium is attained at a very high O by C ratio. And if you convert it, it is around 70% CO remains in equilibrium with the FeO and Fe. So you can understand the utilization of the CO is very less. That means it is around 30% utilization of CO. So if you reduce the temperature, then you can find that your O by C ratio decreases, or the equilibrium volume percentage of CO can be decreased significantly. Okay. So as a result, you can increase the utilization of CO. So as a result, you can see there is the Oosterite, there is the Oosterite equilibrium point. You can shift it from in this direction. So W to W prime. As a result, your emission also here, that is the B to C. It goes to the B to the C point. Okay, so it moves this thing. So you can reduce the coke rate because the slope is decreasing. You can find significantly the slope is decreasing. So you can reduce the coke rate, you can reduce the emission. So think is that if you can decrease the temperature of Oosterite iron equilibrium, that means the isothermal zone in the blast furnace where basically most of the reduction, this is the indirect reduction take place. And for that, what is needed is that you have to increase the coke reactivity, then it is possible, or you can use iron load cool composite pellets where basically the carbon and the iron load is very intimately mixed, or you can use the external reform gas in the shaft furnace. Okay, so that way, so you can, if you can reduce, that is the temperature of isothermal zone where basically Oosterite iron equilibrium is attained in the blast furnace, so you can reduce the carbon rate. And for that, what is required, that is the, it is not easy to reduce the isothermal zone temperature because your carbon gasification reaction has to take place, and that is the highly endothermic reaction. So if you want to promote that, you have to have a very high reactivity of the coke, that is for sure. So emission mitigation through the sequestration and use of biofuel. This is the area that is the most recent interest to this. That is the biomass application. And biomass application can be done in the different, these routes are there. You can use it in the sintering of solid fuel. You can use it in the coke making. And the most important thing is the clear fuel injection as charcoal, because if you can replace the PCI, pulverized coal, by charcoal, then it has been found, it has been proven that you can 100%, you can replace the PCI completely by the charcoal. The MOSA has reported, and those experiments are all based on very high scale experiment also, scale up experiment, and they have shown that it's 100% replacement is possible. So that way, you can reduce the emission. He calculated and he found that maximum 40% that is the reduction in the CO2 is possible. As a result, you can come down to a CO2 emission value of 1.3 tons per ton of crude steel. And CO2 sequestration, that is also possible. It has been reported that you can, by sequestration, this is the carbon capture and sequestration storage, by the CCS, you can reduce the carbon avoidance is possible up to 65%. So that is possible. So you can bring down the CO2 emission to 0.8 ton of CO2 per ton of steel with sequestration. But the major problem is that sequestration cost. Cost is very high. It is around $60 to $90 per ton of CO2 sequestered. So in this case, government intervention through introducing incentives like tax rebate and all these things are required, because otherwise who is going to cost so much of money. So bioenergy, carbon capture and storage, and both, if you can use the bioenergy as well as carbon capture and storage, and that can reduce the VFBF reduction much below the 0.6 ton of CO2 per ton of crude steel to achieve the 2 degree centigrade scenario. So that is possible. So now I come to some of the driving force for alternative routes of iron making. As I have already talked about one, two processes, I have just listed here some of the routes. One thing is that, as I said, there is the coke. Coke is a very costly material because it is it constitutes more than 50% of the total hot metal production. The cost of coke is very high. So that is one of the reasons. Second is the utilization of the non-coking coal, the reserve for which is plenty throughout the world. Utilization of iron-bearing solid waste from the steel plant and utilization of low-grade iron ore. And finally, but not the least, there's the minimization of emission. So if you want to shift the fuel, that is the from the carbon-based to the gas-based process, basically methane is the low-carbon fuel, you know, CH4. So fuel shift, so low-carbon fuel for producing iron, synthetic gas, hydrogen. Hydrogen steel making nowadays is a buzzword. So this is the reasons basically for the emission point of view, that is the thing. So processes are already there. That is called the direct reduction process and the smelting reduction process, as I tried to show there. So various direct reduction technologies, how it's evolved over the years, I have just given it. Basically, initially, it was the Hoganas process. That is when the non-coking coal was first used to produce the solid iron in a staggers, in a tunnel kiln. And then came the small shaft furnace, the Weber process, where basically carbon was gasified outside, and then the gasified deformed gas, synthetic gas, was used into a shaft. There's the Weber process. And after that, rotary kiln came. In the rotary kiln, what happens? It is a cylindrical reactor tilting little, and then it rotates, okay? And you can use the coal and the iron ore. And one end, and other end, you can get the DRI. That is a very robust process, rotary kiln process, that is also based on coal. And from 50s onwards, that is the, from the end of 50s, that is the from 60s onwards, the, all the gas-based process came, basically the HOIL-1 process, the fluidized bed reactor, fire process came. And finally, the static reactors was replaced by a shaft furnace, continuous shaft furnace, from the end of 1960s. And then the Midrex HOIL-3, they came. They are also based on the gas-based process. And currently, we have the rotary hot furnace. So that is the first-met process, in-metro process. These are basically rotary hot furnace-based, rotary hot furnace-based process. Here, basically, the advantage of the rotary hot furnace is that basically here, the material doesn't move. This is the rotating hot that basically carries the material from one point to the another through the different temperature regime. For the reduction. So as a result, you can use a very low grade raw material. Then the self-reforming process is also there. Basically, in the Midrex and the HOIL-3, you require a reformer. In case of the Midrex, the off-gas from the shaft, that is the CO2, is used as an in the reformer, or in case of the HOIL-3 process, it is basically steam is used for reforming the natural gas. HOIL-4, no reformer is required. You can in situ reform the gas inside the reactor itself. impedance of iron catalyst, because your nascent iron that is forming, that acts as a catalyst, and you can reform the natural gas inside the reactor, so you don't require any external reformer. That is the H2L4. Okay, so product of radic reduction is called sponge iron. Why does it called as sponge iron? It doesn't feel like a sponge, obviously, but if you take a microstructure, you can see its micropores are there, and this look like this, and it exactly looks like a sponge. That's why it is called sponge iron. Okay. So different DR technologies are there. This is fluidized bed reactor. Are there fire process, circuit, fin bed? These are all fluidized bed reactor. And these are the shaft based reactor, Midrex and HUL3. Here basically use the natural gas and pellets or lumpy ore. You can use it. And there are coal based process, basically rotary kiln based process, where you use the non cooking coal, lumpy iron ore, and the pellets also you can use it. In India, several this rotary kiln based process developed, and using some breakthrough technologies such that they can utilize the local needs. There's the local ore and all this thing. And you have, these are some of the process where basically the rotary furnace is used, and mostly to utilize the waste. There is the solid iron bearing solid waste from the plant, and you can use the fine ore also, coal, the rotary furnace. And the rotary furnace based process, it is called the no metal solid, because the metallization is restricted to 80%, not more than that. Then you can either directly use it submerged furnace, or you can directly use it into the blast furnace as a metallized feed. And then you get the hot metal, then you can electric arc furnace, you can refine it along with DRI. That is produced from these three routes. So the DRI or the iron carbide also you can produce, and then you can melt in electric arc furnace to produce the steel. Electric arc furnace, slowly it is growing, its use is increasing day by day, because electric arc furnace has the flexibility of accepting the raw materials. It can accept the cold and the hot charge in any proportion. That makes the electric arc furnace very popular nowadays, because the basic oxygen furnace, that is the LD furnace, has a limitation of 20% of cold charge. So it cannot accept more than 20%, because it is an autogenous process. Heat is generated by chemical reaction. So that heat is just sufficient to accommodate 20% of the cold charge. But nowadays, DRI and all these solid metallics are increasing day by day because of DRI production. So as a result, EAF, that is the electric arc furnace, is also gaining its popularity. So this is the features of rotary kiln process. You can see it is a cylindrical reactor, tilted slightly, and it rotates, and the material from the feed end slowly moves to the, there is a discharge end by gravity and by the movement of the rotation. And during this movement, the solid state reduction takes place. So basically you can see there are a lot of burners up there. And in this case, in rotary kiln, you have coal act as both as the heat generator as well as reductant, because from both ends you give the coal. From the feed end you give the coal, for as a reductant, and from the discharge end also you give coal, pulverized coal, for burning, for heat generation. Okay, so basically the coal here used as a heat generator as well as reductant. So there is a scope for fuel switching, because it is a very emitting process. You can see the emission is around 2.2 ton per ton of DRI. It is not the liquid product. Then again, when you want to melt it, then electric arc furnace is required. That also requires electricity and corresponding emission. So it is not at all a very emission-wise, it is much worse process. But you have in scope for switching the fuel. Basically, you can replace the coal by natural gas, such that there is the low carbon fuel you can use. But it is a very rugged process, and that's why it is still popular. But waste gas cleaning and waste heat recovery is very essential, because around 40% of the heat goes at the 40% of the, basically the energy, input energy, leaves as waste gas. Okay, because in this process, you have only 10 to 15% solid bed, and rest is the that is the free bolt because of heat transfer limitation. Because the heat only transfer from the top to the bed, so the solid bed cannot be too high. So as a result, you have this problem is there, and then so whatever is coming out, 40% energy comes out in the waste gas, and then the waste gas has to be cleaned, and then your waste heat recovery is essential, such that the process become economic. And major problem in this, it is a very rugged reactor. It runs smooth. The only problem is the accretion condition, and accretion looks like this. It can be as dangerous like this. So after some time, no feed material can cross through it. Accretion formation basically take place because of fusion of the fines, okay? And so that can be controlled by controlling the operating parameter like rotating speed and the inclination like that to some extent. And also using proper coal such that it doesn't have too much of ash. And the ore quality and ash quality also has to be checked such that accretion formation doesn't take place. Otherwise, it is a very rugged reactor. But still, from emission point of view, it is not a very good reactor unless some fuel switching can be thought about. Now, this is the rotary head furnace. As I said, a rotary head furnace, it looks like a donut, right? It is a donut-like shape you can find. And here, the material enters from here. And basically, a rotating heart basically carries the material from different temperature digging, there is the preheating zone, and then the reduction zone, and the cooling zone, and finally discharge from the other end. Okay, so this is the rotary earth furnace. The advantage of the rotary earth furnace is that it carries the material. So as a result, the strength of the raw material is not a deciding factor. So that's why you can use any kind of waste material into the rotary earth furnace. That is the advantage. And input is usually in terms of iron ore coal composite pellets, and the product is sponge iron, or it can be nugget. If you have, basically for the nugget formation, you require another extra zone with a high temperature around 1300 degrees centigrade and above, such that you can make the slag metal separation, and then finally you can get the nugget out of it. Okay, and this type of reactor are dual fuel based because natural gas is used for heating and the coal is used for nugget. There is a reduction. As a result, its emission is less. And also it requires a lower land space, but it has the major limitation. Its productivity is very low because here also you do not have maximum one or two layers of pellets you can use, because here the feed material is iron ore coal composite pellets. And you can use only a two-layer or maximum two-layer. This is the major limitation. And this is the flow sheet of a first made process. You can see the cold rate is around 400 kg. It is better than, definitely much better than your rotary kiln. But it also requires natural gas of 10 normal meter cube. The input energy 10 gigajoule, and the CO2 emission is 1.2 ton per ton of DRI, is compared to 2.2 ton for rotary kiln process. Or you can see 1.5 ton per ton of iron or 1.8 ton per ton of hot metal. If you consider 0.3 ton carbon equivalent to electricity, because it has been found that 400, because to melt 1 ton of iron, you require around 400 kilowatt of electricity. And 400 kilowatt of electricity is equivalent to 0.3 tons or ton of CO2, basically. Okay. So finally, it produces around 1.8 ton CO2. So this is not bad, actually. If you compare with the blast furnace, BFBF process, that goes around 2.1 like that. So here it is 1.8 ton per ton of hot metal. But the bottleneck of this process is that productivity is very, very less and compared to the blast furnace. But this rotary earth furnace RHF process should not be compared with the blast furnace from productivity point of view. It can never compete with that. But the advantage is that rotary earth furnace can use, it can act as a scavenger. So it can use the waste iron bearing solid waste from the steel part. That is the advantage. And this is the ITMT3 process. You can see, as I said, you require this is the reducing after detection. This is the high temperature zone. What happens is that in the high temperature zone, the iron gets carburized and it melts. Iron basically melts and the slag remains in the semi-solid state. So iron basically accumulate to a big ball like a nugget. And finally, after quenching, when you crush it, the slag gets separated and you can get the nugget. So this is the nugget process. Okay, it is a very fast process, 10 minutes, and the process emits at least 20% less CO2 than the blast furnace. So that is the ITMT3 process, but it's still not very much commercialized. It has been demonstrated, but not commercialized. So now I come to the smelting reduction process again. And as I said, in a true sense, smelting reduction process should be a single reactor where you take the iron ore, coal, and oxygen and melt everything and then reduce into the liquid state. And then you get the product like hot metal and the slag and gas also that come out, that is the off gas. But the major problem is that off gas credit is very high because in this process, the coal rate is very high. That is the, as a result, off gas credit is also very high. Unless you utilize the gas, this process can never be economic. So to reduce the off gas credit, some two-stage reactor came where you have a reduction unit and a melting unit. And you can connect these two reactors by the solid and the gas stream this way. So the melting reduction, whatever the reducing gas is generated, that goes into the reduction unit. And after finally, you get the off gas. So this off gas credit is little less compared to the off gas credit here. So the burden of the off gas decreases in the two-stage reactor. And in this two-stage reactor, you can find it similar to blast furnace, but these two reactors are completely separated, independent. As a result, you don't have problem with the, what is that called? There's the permeability and all this thing too much. So you can control the reduction unit independently. You can control the melting unit independently. That is the advantage. So you can use some low-grade wood, low-grade raw material here. And another smelting reduction process has come, but it is not yet commercialized. That is, you use a gasifier in between, and that way it works. And in two-stage reactor, that is, a lot of processes are there already. Corex is a very well-known process. Then you have Phoenix process is there. And in case of the single reactor process is the high smell process, Hisarna. These are the single reactor process I'll come to. This is the flow sheet of the Corex you can find. This is the reduction unit. It is the melter gasifier. And then here the cold rate you can find, cold rate around 1,000 kgs. Cold rate is quite high compared to the blast furnace you consider. Input rate is high and the specific energy consumption also 16 gigajoule compared to blast furnace is 11.5 gigajoule. And the megawatt generated, that is the off gas, obviously off gas has to be used for steam raising and power generation. And megawatt generated from the off gas is around 120 megawatt. And net CO2 emission, if you take the credit, carbon credit for generating the electricity, then your net CO2 emission will be 1.1 per ton of hot metal. So it is very comparable with the blast furnace process from that point of view. So if you use the off gas properly, then this process becomes very comparable. And besides the Corex process, if you use the off gas of the Corex for in a DRI plant, then you can generate some extra iron, right? You can produce extra. So as a result, your specific emission will decrease. So that is also a possibility of utilization. That's why some of the Corex plant are duplexing with the DRI plant, okay? Because you are generating some extra iron, yeah. This is the flow sheet of the Phoenix. In case of the Phoenix, the reduction takes place in a fluidized bed reactor. Okay, this is the fluidized bed reactors are there where basically you generate, you pre-reduce the iron ore fines. Here you directly use the fines. You don't have to pelletize it just like into the Corex process. You have to pelletize and you use it into the reduction unit. Here directly you can use the fines and you can reduce them in fluidized bed reactor. After that, you can hot, that is the compact the iron, hot compacting iron, and then you can charge it into the melter basifier. And similarly, non-coking coal after drying, you can compact it, and the coal briquette is also charged. And then in the melter gasifier, everything melts, and then rest of the reduction take place and also melting take place. And you can get the iron, hot metal. And the off gas, you basically, this is the off gas after you take out the CO2, and partially the off gas is recycled back to the fluidized bed reactor. And the rest of the off gas is used for the power generation, oxygen plant, and that basically feed the plant itself. This is the process in the POSCO, and they have generated the process, and in the POSCO only this unit exists. And this is the Rowelt process. It is a single stage reactor, smelting reduction reactor, and it has excellent hot metal quality. You can find there is the coal, iron ore, fines, oxygen, everything is done, and you can take out the pig iron, and you can see there is something is called the active bath, where basically some impurity partitioning take place. Basically, here, whatever the hot metal you get, there the sulfur and phosphorus is significantly low. So you are close to the steel, okay? That is the advantage. But main problem with this reactor is that its carbon date is very high, 1,500 to 2,000 kg per ton of hot metal. So extremely high. So you're obviously it is not at all sustainable. It was invented in Russia, and pilot scale demonstration has been done, but it not commercialized. So material flow diagram, this is this, and this is the Hiswell process. this process you can find unique in this nature, that here instead of oxygen, you basically use here the oxygen enriched air blast. So oxygen enriched air blast and preheated air blast at 1200 degrees centigrade is charged from the top, just like in the LD vessel, just from the top. And the iron ore and the coal fines are injected. Dried iron ore and coal fines are injected into the liquid bath such that they can melt easily, okay? And this is the unique feature of this process. And since you are giving a lot of sensible heat through nitrogen, that's why the cold rate is less here. And you can find the cold rate is significantly less, 650 kg. It is less than Codex process also. And is SEC is 16 gigajoule, net CO2 emission 1.6 ton after carbon credit for power generation. So it is even lower than the Codex process. This is the another view of insight of the Hiswell process. This is the Hisarna process. This is also a developed by basically Tata Steel Europe and Rio Tinto, and also Wilcos is also involved into it. And it is also a single stage reactor. You can find in the upper part, this is called the CCF, cyclone converter furnace, and this is called the smelting reduction vessel. Basically here you give the inject the coal oxygen here, and you make some reduction and melting process. And whatever the CO gas come out here completely the CO is combusted here. There's a post-combustion of the CO gas take place in this region, complete post-combustion. So whatever the gas that comes out is pure carbon dioxide. So as a result, you have a very good chance of sequestering the CO2 because it is pure carbon dioxide. So you can easily sequester it. And that is the advantage. And its coal rate is around 750 kg per ton of hot metal. Emission is 2 tons per hot metal, but if you sequester the carbon dioxide, then after sequestration, its emission decreases to 0.4 ton per ton of hot metal. But major limitation is that it has been tested only in a very small scale, around 200 kg per day, but it has been operative for 6 month plant trials, but it has not been commercialized. Scale up is yet to be realized. So this is the Hisarna, but it is a very promising from that point of view that it can have a very low emission in spite of being a totally carbon-based process. It has a potential of developing as a sustainable steelmaking process, but scale up is yet to be realized. So So another sustainable process that is coming is the coal gasification based DRI solution. And in India, basically more than 30% steel, liquid steel is produced through the DRI route. And most of the DRI is produced by the coal based process because we do have a lack of domestic scrap. So for Indian coal, which is, contains a very high S content, there the Lurgi gasifier is found to be very suitable because Lurgi always operate at a very high pressure but low temperature below the ash fusion temperature, such that you can separate the ash in the solid state. So high ash coal you can use in the Lurgi gasifier. And after that, you can use a hydrogen enriching gas because you can do the water gas shift reaction, because whatever the CO is generated. So by shifting by steam, you can shift the CO by steam to hydrogen. You can get an hydrogen enriching gas, and then you can use it into a mid-rest reactor for mid-rest shaft reactor for reduction. And already India has one such reactor, that is the JSPL Angul. They have around 2 million tons per annum. This reactor is there. And it has potential for the CO2 sequestration. And if you can sequester the CO2, then it can be a really a good sustainable process for the future. But the problem is the sequestration. So unless we sequester it, the CO2, then its emission remains quite high. Hydrogen steel making definitely is a promising steel making process because emission is zero when you produce the, if the electricity basically for melting, when you produce the DRI, emission is zero. And for melting, you have to use the electric arc furnace. So if you can generate the electricity from renewable source, then it is a completely steel making process, become completely zero emission process. But the major problem is that renewable hydrogen, because hydrogen you can produce from both sources. That is the fossil fuel as well as renewable source. But renewable source means basically you have to produce the hydrogen from electrolysis and you require the electrolyzer. And that capacity is not very high presently today. Current global renewable hydrogen production is around 1 million ton. And out of 90 million ton of hydrogen is produced by from the fossil fuel, that is the methane. Okay, and it emits around 900 million tons of CO2. Okay, so entire steel production, if you want to say 2050, you want to produce 2,500 million tons, and if you want to produce the entire steel by hydrogen, then it requires the electrolyzer capacity of 1,000 gigawatt, a very impossible proposition. So it is not possible. So always we have to use the hydrogen in a fuel mixing form, because renewable hydrogen, production of renewable hydrogen, for that we need to grow the capacity of the electrolyzer. That is the point. And you can see the cost of renewable hydrogen around $5 per ton, whereas from the fossil fuel by steam reforming of methane, that is the SRM, and that is around only $2.5 per ton. So renewable hydrogen is twice that of the fossil fuel based hydrogen. So now, how much time I have? Okay, I will just some of our research on the RHS steel making I would like to tell. These are some of our publications, and based on that, I will just tell. So one of our recent research by one of our PhD students who has carried out, along with Professor Sen, we have guided him, that is, it does an energy exergy analysis of the RHABA process, and we have compared the exergy efficiency of the RHABA process with the BRPA process under different conditions. Now, to give a just what is energy and exergy, I will not just go much deep into it. Just I can tell you that is the energy is called the available energy, and exergy is called the available energy, and exergy can be destroyed, but energy is not destroyed, it is just conserved. Okay, so a part of the energy is called the energy, And this is basically when you run a process, some of the input energy is destroyed in the form of entropy generation. Okay. So that's why the available energy from the process that decreases. Okay, that is called the exergy. To give an example, suppose 1 kilojoule energy of hot water at 70 degrees centigrade, if you consider, it has only 0.13 kilojoule of exergy, available energy. 87.87 kilojoule is the energy. Basically, 0.87 kilojoule is destroyed in the form of entropy generation. So you can understand. So from the exergy analysis, you can judge a process efficiency, a reactor efficiency you can judge. And so basically, in case of the exergy calculation, you take the whatever that is the any compound that exists into the nature that is taken as the standard state, like I don't know, hematite ore, that will be taken as the standard state. Okay, and with reference to this, the pure metal exergy you can calculate. So pure metal exergy you can calculate, and this pure metal exergy basically available in literature. People has calculated the pure metal exergy, and the from pure element exergy you can calculate in your stream what are the compounds are there, what are the free energy chains, that you can simply calculate from the thermodynamics, formation and energy, and you can calculate what is the exergy of the stream at a reference temperature T0 and P0, and then you can calculate the exergy of the steam at certain temperature. There's a process temperature and pressure. And this is also from thermodynamics using this formulation delta is not minus T naught delta is not. So you have two components. Basically, this is called the physical exergy and this is called the chemical exergy. Okay.
It's almost two, maybe 5 minutes.
Okay, just. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So the this is your total input exergy, and this is the total metal exergy out. Then you can get the efficiency of the metal exergy, and that way. And similarly, if you consider the useful product as the metal as well as the gas, if you compare the total exergy associated with the metal and the gas to that of total input exergy, that is called the gas-based exergy. So what we found is that that is the at low scrap ratio, the exergy index of the BF-BF process steel making route is superior to the RHA-BF process. Always superior when the scrap ratio is less. But when the scrap ratio become high, more than 40%, if you compare the BF-BF and the RHA-BF process, then RHA-BF process become more efficient compared to the BF-BF process. This is the result. And net CO2 emission also has been found to be much less in case of the RHA process compared to the BF-BF process. When your scrap ratio is high, and also when you transfer the DRI in a hot condition to the EF. Okay, some of the CFD analysis on the, I will just talk about this and then I close. We have done some CFD analysis on the RHA, and yeah, what is the model? We have basically developed two models independently, one for the your pellet reduction, that is called the solid reduction model, and another is called the CFD model in the freeboard of the RHA. And then we have coupled it, okay, through a boundary condition. So we have developed two independent models, and then we have coupled it through the boundary condition, basically by the CO flux and the heat flux. And based on that, some of the interesting results that we get is that there is the highest level of temperature with enhanced combustion efficiency. We can increase the combustion efficiency if we change the nozzle configuration. We have used three nozzle configuration. We have found that this type of nozzle configuration, that is the case one, this is come out to the best nozzle configuration for combustion efficiency. And similarly, we have used emission analysis with alternative fuels, and we found that blast furnace and COG gas, if you use that and input gas to the RHA, the blast furnace and COG gas combination can produce much less CO2 compared to BF, COG and NG combination. This is a very interesting result because you can see that it is better always used to BF and COG, not the natural gas is not required here. because natural gas is costly also. So with BF and CUG, if you just mix up this gas, and then you can carry out with the lower emission. We have studied the oxygen enrichment also, and with oxygen enrichment, obviously the fuel rate decreases, but the major problem is that the gas, the overlying gas over the pellet surface remains oxidizing. That is the major disadvantage. As a result, what we suggested is that after producing the DRI, we have to either charge the pellet in the hot condition to the electric arc furnace, or we have to cool it in a inert atmosphere, and then you can use it. Okay, right, fine. So these are some of the results we have, not some other results. And another interesting point is that in the rotary earth furnace, the most interesting result that we got is that the hematite, that is the Fe2O3 to carbon ratio, the internal coal in the composite pellet that you used, you don't repair at the stoichiometric level. You can use it as the below the stoichiometric level for the direct reduction, okay? Because I can use both this reaction, and we found that this reaction is that it happens when you can utilize the CO gas most efficiently, okay? So, and we have found indeed that is the degree of reduction very high at C by Fe2O3 ratio of 1.66 in place of, that is the 3. 3 is not required. So, that's, we can save the carbon significantly in the RHE process. We don't have to go for a very, because you can increase the CO utilization significantly. Okay, thank you. And just one more point, that is, we produced also the nugget from nugget formation at 1300 for different shape. We found that if you use different prefabricated pellets, if you use some pellets with a higher surface area, then you can produce the nugget more easily and more effectively, because in that case, the slag metal separation becomes much easier. Okay, that's why you can find a nugget here. When you take a cut sphere, when you take a car, there is the sphere you can get when you take a cut sphere like that. So, and we have found that if you use the tablet set pellets, then your nugget formation or slag metal separation become much faster. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for taking a little more time. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Jijirai, for a wonderful talk, taking us through some of the alternative iron making processes. Interesting to see a lot of different iron making routes. So I request anybody to have question?
Hi. Hi, Professor Jijirai. This is Jushri from the Steel Group. India is the steel demand is increasing, and India has your own unique resources like gas or I think the alternative iron making in India is quite competitive, is at a high ratio. So we are facing the climate change, all sorts of carbon neutral, and the India is looks like it's building loads of steel iron making plants. But from now on or for the future, what will be the main direction, or is the government in giving some like guidance to say, okay, for the carbon neutral things, we have to build a new steel plant based in this process. What's your view or what's the information from your?
Right. Thank you. Thank you very much for this question. Yes, indeed, because you see, like India, we have to stay on the coal-based process, actually. That will be there. Blast furnace, BFBA process, that will still dominate in the years to come. So we basically, and also, obviously, we'll supplement some of the steel production by the alternative routes like DRI production, and that will be also coal-based. So our approach will be basically to use the bioenergy right? As I said, if you can replace some PCI by the bio, there is a charcoal, that would be one aim. And you can use the BioCenter, BioCoke, and all these things. Our research has to go in that area. And besides, that is the coal-based DRI process, and we can go for the coal gasification and sequestration. That is the important. If you can gasify the coal, and then you sequester the carbon dioxide, and then use that hydrogen and be syngassed into the mid-test type of furnace as JSPL has installed. So that may be, I think, to me, that are the process that should India should go for. Because we have a lot of reserves for carbon, and we don't have much of reserve for what is that called, natural gas. We are very limited by the natural gas resource. Okay, so we cannot go in a big way for DRI production using the low carbon fuel like natural gas. What we have to do, we have to use the coal, we have to gasify the coal, but we have to keep our attention such that we can sequester the CO2. That we have to invent some way. That is the how to sequestration can be taken off. And another thing is that's why the government may have some intervention by using tax rebate for carbon, there's a CO2 avoidance program and like that. That is one thing. And another thing is the bioenergy application. That has to be there. That I feel is at this point, because at this point, the coal-based economy, basically coal-based iron production, that is the route if you can. Because hydrogen also, if you consider the hydrogen, India is also going for that. That is, in that case, the electrolyzer capacity-wise and also the cost-wise, this is a major deterrent for the hydrogen steel making. Still now, even globally, it is global even in India, of course. So because the cost of hydrogen has to be reduced. And for that, we have to make it much cheaper hydrogen, renewable hydrogen, that is the from electrolyzer. That cost has to be reduced. That is the research has to go on. I do not know. Then hydrogen obviously is an option. Yeah. But we can, because you can see the hydrogen from the fossil fuel, that also we cannot do that. We do not have much of methane. So we can only produce the hydrogen from the coal only, okay, by water gasship reaction. That we can do. But think is that we have to sequester the CO2. Otherwise, we'll be there. That is my
So thank you for that. As a first of all, and each
country is different. It is completely my opinion, not the government.
Different countries has a different.
Yeah.
Adapt a different process, and the carbon dioxide sequestrations is CCU or CCS is the main.
Yeah.
Is the main process route going forward or not?
Thing is that is also storage, because for storage those plants near to the sea, that is the problem. That is also CCUS is a problem. There's the utilization. We have to think for some utilization, like if we can convert the blast furnace CO2 H2 and CO2 methane, like that. But that is the utilization. CCU, this type of program we can have. Storage, I do not know how much storage we can do. That is a problem. We can definitely separate the CO2, but storage is a problem that people have to think about. I find it a little difficult at this moment. But CCU, we can think about. That is the carbon capture and utilization. But that capacity also may not be very high at this moment. But we have to find out. So,
okay, final question from me, Aprika, sorry.
You can.
What's the target for the carbon neutral of steel making in India? Is it 2050 or 2035? Or?
Yeah, we know that our PM also have signed this climate policy change. So something government will also do. Some government intervention will definitely be there. We do not know what is... And in India also has a target of, and now India is producing 106 million ton. Now it has a target to go to 300 million ton by 2030. So it is expanding also, but CO2 is at the same time is a problem. Let's see how it develops actually. My opinion, I have said now, how the government point of view, how it is developed, I am not very sure at this moment.
you. Thank you so much. It's really nice discussion. Thank you.
Hello, Prakash.
Yes.
Hello. Thank you very much for your presentation. I must be honest, I'm not an expert in this field. And yeah, we do have this RNA process. But just for my personal, I mean, I'm not the expert in this area, definitely not. But I would like to know direct reduction with hydrogen. Is that something? Is that something which is what is your vision on it?
Yeah, that is the thing I wanted to tell, that even to produce, suppose if you want to produce 1 billion ton of hydrogen, the DRI using hydrogen, okay, so that will require around 500 megawatt of electrolyzer. Yep. That capacity has to be around 500 megawatt of electrolyzer. Otherwise, if you produce less, in that case, you have to mix the gas. There is the hydrogen with the natural gas. I think that is the solution at this moment, because capacity building on the electrolyzer is not very high. As I give you some data, that is out of 90 million ton of there is the hydrogen that is produced. That is mostly, that is the 90 million ton is produced by the fossil fuel, that is the steam reforming of natural gas. And only 1 million ton is produced by the renewable source, that is by the electrolyzer. Okay, so so hydrogen steel making, it will take some time. Actually, for the development of the renewable hydrogen, that process will require some more time, I think. It is not going to come very quickly, that is the thing. Because hydrogen, just like you see, that is the oxygen steel making. So we didn't have the oxygen steel making for a long time. We operated with the open hearth harness, right? Because we didn't have oxygen at cheap cost at that time. That's why we struggled with this open hearth harness with a very low productivity for a long time. When the Linde-Frankel process came with the cheap production of oxygen, immediately the LD furnace came and your productivity jumped significantly. So similarly, we are finding some technology or something that will produce the hydrogen at a cheaper rate, or at a hydrogen production should come to a very large scale such that it becomes cheap, and then only it will be feasible. Otherwise, because hydrogen as a reductant is well established. So if you can if you can supply the hydrogen, then producing steel is not a problem. Mm-hmm. That is not a problem. But the root cause is the hydrogen. How will you produce the renewable hydrogen?
Yeah, the amount, yes, of course.
Yeah, amount is very huge amount of hydrogen.
Yeah, steel. I know.
Supply that. And then for that, we'll give you. Then if you take it from the renewable source, there is a from fossil fuel also, that is also natural gas also, that much supply is not there. We'll give that.
So what is your vision on, for example, SSAB, which have the hybrid technology, and they announced that they have hydrogen produced steel, probably supported with nuclear energy.
Yeah, maybe. I don't want to comment at this moment with this nuclear energy, how much it will be there. I don't know either.
I saw SSAB is promoting this, and I saw Sweden is 40% is supplying their electricity with nuclear power plants. So I guess they is a nuclear power plant.
If you have nuclear power plant, then only electricity can be supplied from there. Yeah, then that will be the that is the thing that can be. Yeah. That can be another source. Yeah, people have to think that way. But nuclear plant also setting up those things also has a lot of problem everywhere. Anyway, so
Of course.
Thank you, Just. Danny, I saw that you want to ask a question.
Yeah, I mean, I had very similar questions around hydrogen as well. I mean, I posted in the chat as well, and I was wondering once, and it was kind of answered that once. Like the quantity of hydrogen is produced, and I guess it's the more is needed, the more is produced. What other challenges there might be to integrate it in existing steel plants? What other challenges? But you said, like in one of the previous sentences, once it's there, it would be easy.
Yeah.
But if there's anything else you might want to add to that, what other challenges existing steel plants might face to integrate it?
Yeah, in that case, that is the thing. If provided, suppose today, if you are giving a lot of hydrogen, no problem. In that case, what is the existing assets are there in the steel plant, like blast furnace, BOF, and they have their long life. So people don't want to do away with them very quickly because they have invested so much for these units, okay? So that will be another challenge. So suddenly, if hydrogen is available now today, if you say, I'm giving you hydrogen, you just switch off all the existing asset and only produce the DRI by sharp furnace and melt it in lithium furnace. So that will also not be very easy at this moment because nobody would like to do away with their assets that they have invested so much. So that's why the BFBF process that is already there, that will continue for some more time. Even if you consider the other things are also available in place. So at the parallelly, the hydrogen also has to produce. I think that is that will be another challenge. You provided the hydrogen is available in the market. So you cannot just dwell with those existing assets in the steel plant.